it and cleaned it, they found that there were some remarkable objects, namely sun, moon, and stars.
The Nebra Sky Disk is embossed with gold leaf images of the sun, a crescent moon, and 32 stars. Tests have revealed that the bronze disk was originally stained black, creating a remarkable picture of the Bronze Age night sky.
This is the earliest picture of the cosmos. This is the first cosmos made in bronze and gold. So I think this is one of the most important archaeological finds for the history of religion and for the history of astronomy.
In this picture of the night skies, one distinctive star cluster may give a clue to the real purpose of the disk.
One clear group of stars, and we think it's Pleiades, the seven stars in the sky.
In the northern hemisphere, the Pleiades star cluster sets in the western sky at dawn around the time of the spring equinox, and sets in the eastern sky at dawn, close to the autumn equinox.
We think it was marking the beginning and ending of the agricultural year, namely 10th of March for the beginning and 15th of October for the ending of the agricultural year.
It's a celestial sowing and harvesting sign, still recognized by farmers today. But the sky disk has more secrets to reveal.
It may have been used in a horizontal position and looking from this part of the rim to this part, in this way.
The gold strips placed on the edge of the disk mark the position of sunrise on the 21st of June and the 21st of December, midsummer and midwinter's day. Just like a modern calendar, the sky disk marks four magical dates in the year.
And these are the main dates for the farming people in ancient time.
So in a way, what you're really saying is that this is like a miniature megalith. It's a miniature Stonehenge or Newgrange. It's a lot lighter.
In a special way, it is a miniature Stonehenge.
Tracking time played a crucial role in a farming society dominated by the changing seasons. Now, new evidence reveals that our ancestors were already doing that thousands of years, even before the Nebra disk was made.
Here on the outskirts of a small German town named Goseck stood a wooden henge 7,000 years ago.
And what was remarkable was that over here there was a gate where the sun rose on the winter solstice, and another gate was over there where the sun rose on the summer solstice.
And what's really amazing about this is it was 2,500 years before Stonehenge.
Yet there's a striking connection between this henge and the Nebra star disk. The angle formed between the midsummer and midwinter sunrise is 82 degrees, exactly the same angle as the horizon lines marked on the Nebra disk. But that's not surprising, because although 3,500 years separate this Neolithic henge and the Bronze Age disk, both are marking the same magical events of midsummer's and midwinter's day. But whoever used this disk had much more than knowledge of the heavens in their hands.
The main point is not that it is a practical instrument, it's a symbol of knowledge and it's a magic instrument. Mm-hmm. People who knew everything about the stars knew also everything about magic and religion.
So the Nebra disk was also a sacred magical tool for Bronze Age priests. It seems to me that part of its power was that it contained knowledge that most people could not have understood. Just like today's scientists and computer wizards, knowledge is magic.
It was definitely magic to the simple farmer, but it might have been some kind of science to the educated priest. So both mixed, magic to the simple people, science to the priest.
The same as today, really.
Same as today, you're right. Yeah.
Archaeologists can only guess at the identity of the people who made this disk 3,600 years ago. But where can I find evidence of the people who knew how to use this disk and wield its power? The actual magicians of this ancient world.
to do that, I've come to Denmark to see the otherworldly goods of a real Bronze Age magician.
The bogs of Denmark have preserved many clues to the daily life and beliefs of the Bronze Age. Here, magic had a clear purpose. In an uncertain world, magical rituals were deemed necessary to honor the rising sun every day.
The sun was a symbol of all essential cosmic powers of the world. The sun was simply everything.
If magic here was about controlling natural forces, then who were the magicians? The clues may lie in the contents of this Bronze Age grave. Here, there was no body. But what had survived was a medical pouch with an extraordinary range of objects. They included tweezers, hawk's claws, and snake's tails.
It's a bit like, you know, Shakespeare's Macbeth, you know, I have Newton. It's very much like a witchcraft.
Yes, that's really things you would put into a witch brew.
Were they practical or symbolic? We can only speculate as to the purpose of these sacred objects.
The snake tail is related to the earth. The claw of the hawk is related to the sky. The conch is related to the sea. All these elements brought together could be used for carry out magic in relation to the notions of the voyage of the sun cult, the spring, the cyclical times of the year, all that.
There was one more clue that would give me a picture of this magician. Along with the tools of his trade was a fragment of his magical costume.
In the grave was found, reasonably well preserved, a little tongue of woolen textiles.
So like a loincloth sort of?
Yes,
down here.
Something like that, but with a little tongue covering your
private parts.
Yes.
What could be the purpose of this odd-shaped piece of fabric? All we do know is that the very same costume appears on a set of miniature Bronze Age figures.
There's this special dress with a tongue here in front and the back, and then he is wearing horned helmets.
And here we have identical full-size versions of both those miniature horned helmets and ceremonial axes.
We call them cult axes because they have no practical use whatsoever.
It hasn't even got an edge on it.
No,
it?
No.
So the tiny bronze figures represent real people and real ceremonies. Our magician in the grave was a priest in the cult of the sun. His job was to keep the sun rising in the sky, because in the Bronze Age, magic and religion were one and the same.
What was the source of his magical power, do you think?
Well, the source was that he had an essential knowledge of the voyage of the sun, of the secrets of cosmos. And as we all know, knowledge is power, but secret knowledge is even more power.
Secret power.
Makes you even more powerful.
Makes you a magician.
Yes, exactly.
I wonder if this magic still works today.
So it still hasn't come out, but it's clearing up a bit.
A little bit.
Another 10 minutes.
Secret knowledge was the source of power for the wizard priests of Denmark. Magicians dressed to impress. Putting on a good show was part of pagan magic, just like stage entertainers do today. But what is a wizard without a magic hat? It was here in Germany in the late Bronze Age that the knowledge of the sun and the moon and the power of the wizard priests combined to produce one of the most remarkable objects of pagan times. For over a century, this Bronze Age treasure lay in museum vaults. This is one of four similar objects. All are over 3,000 years old. It was skillfully made from a single piece of gold. But how?